classification of the antihypertensive medication and their mechanism of actions, and the common side effects of the antihypertensive agents and their therapeutic uses. So, hypertension, it is defined as either a sustained systolic blood pressure of greater than 140 millimeter mercury, or a sustained diastolic pressure of greater than 90 millimeter mercury. And it is the most common serious condition, as we all know. We have, in especially in our country, hypertension is a very prevailing disease in the elderly and even in the young population. So persistent sustained increased BP has damaging effects on the heart, the brain, the kidney, and the eye. And so just like diabetes is a very chronic condition that affects the heart, brain, kidney, and eye. So blood pressure, the increased blood pressure, hypertension causes the same effects. So there are two types of hypertension. Primary essential hypertension, that is, there is non-specific cause in 95% of cases. And secondary hypertension, that is due to specific diseases or drugs in 5% of cases. So mechanism of controlling blood pressure, there are two mechanisms by which our body controls the blood pressure. That is, arterial blood pressure is directly proportional to the cardiac output and the peripheral vascular resistance. So cardiac output and peripheral vascular resistance in turn are controlled mainly by two overlapping controlling mechanisms. That is the baroreceptor reflex by the sympathetic nervous system and the renin-angiotensin and aldosterone system that I'm sure you must have already studied before. So uska ek overview dekh lete hain about how the blood pressure is regulated in the body. So what happens is, when blood pressure is decreased, two things happen. That is, sympathetic activity is increased and the renal blood flow is decreased. So when the sympathetic activity increases, it causes three things. That is, activation of the B1 adrenal receptors of the heart, and the activation of the alpha-1 adrenal receptor on smooth muscles, and increases the activation of beta-1 adrenal receptors on the kidney. So in turn, it increases the cardiac output, it increases the venous return and the peripheral resistance, which in turn increases the blood pressure. So similarly, activation of beta-1 adrenal receptors on the kidney produces renin, and also renal blood flow produces more secretion of renin, which activates the angiotensin 2, which releases aldosterone and increases aldosterone, and in turn increases the sodium and water retention, which increases the blood volume. The blood volume increases, the cardiac output increases, and the blood pressure increases. So this is the whole mechanism by which there is the increase in blood pressure happens. So the drugs that we are going to talk about next will be affecting all these mechanisms, okay? Maybe the beta adrenal receptors at blocking drugs, or alpha-1 blocking drugs, and the drugs that will act on the renin-angiotensin aldosterone system. So classification of the antihypertensive drugs are angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, which are mainly captopril, enalapril, lansoprazole, and ramipril. So the prils are what you need to remember for the AC inhibitors. Okay. Then angiotensin 2 receptor antagonists that are losartan. They're the ARBs. So drug classification of drugs are AC inhibitors. The second is ARBs. Then it's calcium channel blockers like verapamil, difluprednate, and amlodipine. Then comes the diuretics, which are divided into three categories. That is thiazide diuretics, loop diuretics, and potassium sparing diuretics. So thiazide diuretics, we have hydrochlorothiazide. In loop, we have the major drug is the furosemide drug. And potassium sparing diuretic, we know spironolactone. Then there is sympathetic drugs, which are centrally acting, and adrenergic receptor blockers, and alpha blockers, and beta blockers. That is clonidine, prazosin, propranolol, etanolol. All these drugs you have gone through before, but we'll talk about them again. Vasodilators, hydralazine and minoxidil. So there are six categories, which are AC inhibitors, ARBs, calcium channel blockers, diuretics, sympatholytic drugs, and vasodilator drugs. So starting with diuretics, because diuretics can be used as a first-line drug therapy for hypertension unless they are there is a compelling reason to choose another agent. So whenever we get a patient who is not a very elderly patient, he would be 40 to his age is in between 40 to 50 years, and he's coming for the first time, and you have diagnosed him with primary hypertension and he has no other comorbidities. So what will be the first line drug after, of course, the lifestyle modifications? That would be the commencement of diuretic agent first. That can be mainly a thiazide diuretic, which have been found as the widespread use in the treatment of hypertension. So the mechanism of thiazide diuretics, they lower the blood pressure initially by increasing sodium and water excretion. This causes a decrease in extracellular volume, resulting in decrease in cardiac output and the renal blood flow. Sorry? Anybody saying something?
Somebody asked to repeat the last sentence.
Oh, okay. Which one?
I don't know, maybe from the start of thiazide.
Achha, okay. So thiazide is the most widespread use in the treatment of hypertension. It is other thiazide di jati hai. So that would be the first line drug for a patient who doesn't have any other comorbidities. Then we'll start with diuretic drugs. So the mechanism of it is they lower the blood pressure initially by increasing sodium and water excretion. This causes a decrease in extracellular volume, resulting in a decrease in cardiac output and renal blood flow. Potassium sparing diuretics are often used in combination with the thiazide to reduce the amount of potassium loss induced by the thiazide diuretic. So potassium sparing diuretics liye use kiye jaate hain taki the potassium that is lost due to thiazide that can be maintained again by using a potassium sparing drug in patients who are having problems with decreased potassium in the body. So therapeutic uses, thiazide diuretics decrease blood pressure in both supine and standing positions, and postural hypertension is rarely observed. Useful in combination therapy with a variety of other antihypertensive agents. Thiazide diuretics are particularly useful in the treatment of black and elderly patients. So some of the adverse effects of thiazide diuretics are hypokalemia, hyperuricemia, hyperglycemia, hypomagnesemia, hyperglycemia, calcemia, decreased libido, and therefore the thiazide diuretics are mostly preferred in low doses, that is mainly 12.5 milligrams. So the second category is beta adrenoceptor blocking agents. The beta blockers are currently recommended as a first line drug for hypertension with concomitant diseases when the concomitant diseases are present. For example, in post-MI patients or in patients with a previous MI. So the mechanism of action for beta blockers are they reduce the blood pressure primarily by decreasing the cardiac output. They decrease the sympathetic outflow from the central nervous system and inhibit the release of renin from the kidneys, thus decreasing the formation of angiotensin II and the secretion of aldosterone. Some of the side effects, the adverse effects of beta blockers are bradycardia, hypotension, fatigue, lethargy, insomnia, hallucinations, and sexual dysfunctions. So third category is AC inhibitors. Their mechanism is they inhibit the generation of angiotensin II. And they inhibit the degradation of bradykinin, which is a potent vasodilator. which dilates both arteries and veins, and blood flow to the vital organs is increased, and there is a decrease in aldosterone production indirectly. And therapeutic uses: AC inhibitors are most effective in hypertensive patients who are white and young. Hypertension, first line drug for all grades of hypertension, but specifically indicated in hypertension with diabetes, in patients with left ventricular hypertrophy, in patients with congestive heart failure, with myocardial infarction, diabetic nephropathy, and scleroderma renal crisis. Okay, so AC inhibitors is specifically used in these patients. Some of the adverse effects of AC inhibitors are dry cough. Dry cough is the main adverse effects that you definitely need to remember, because that is one of the reasons why AC inhibitors have to be stopped in patients. It causes very severe dry cough. So dry cough, rash, fever, altered taste, hypotension in hypovolemic states, and hyperkalemia and skin rashes. Some of the advantages of AC inhibitors are the lack of postural hypertension. It is also safe in asthmatics and diabetics. It decreases incidence of type 2 diabetes in high risk cases. It prevents potassium loss due to diuretics. No effects on sexual function, and no rebound hypertension, and reverse left ventricular hypertrophy. Then comes the ARBs, that is angiotensin II receptor blockers. The ARBs are alternatives to the AC inhibitors. Their mechanism of action is that they block the AT1 receptor, decreasing the activation of the AT1 receptor by angiotensin II. And the pharmacological effects are similar to those of AC inhibitors. Uses are similar to AC inhibitors, and it is mainly used in patients who cough with ACE inhibitors. So whenever we have to replace AC inhibitors with another drug, that would be the ARBs. So why is it that AC inhibitors can be changed with ARBs? That is because of the advantage, which is that they do not increase the bradykinin levels, so therefore there are less adverse effects like the cough and angioedema that is caused due to AC inhibitors. Other adverse effects of ARBs are phototoxicity, and should not be used in women who are pregnant, headache, weakness, rashes, and vomiting. So then comes the calcium channel blockers. Calcium channel blockers are recommended when the preferred first-line agents are contraindicated or ineffective. They are effective in treating hypertension in patients with angina or diabetes. So the mechanism of action of calcium channel blockers are that calcium enters the muscle cells through the special voltage-sensitive calcium channels. So, calcium channel antagonists block the inward movement of the calcium by binding to the L-type calcium channels in the heart and smooth muscles of the coronary and peripheral arteriovascular. This causes the vascular smooth muscles to relax and dilating the mainly the arterioles. And calcium channel blockers do not dilate veins. So, what it does is जो कैल्शियम चैनल ब्लॉकर्स हैं एल टाइप कैल्शियम चैनल को ब्लॉक करेंगे एंड देन दे विल इन टर्न स्मूथ मसल जो है उसको द इनवर्ड मूवमेंट ऑफ कैल्शियम चैनल्स होगी स्मूथ मसल्स विल रिलैक्स इन द हार्ट एंड द पेरिफेरल आर्टेरियो वैस्कुलर सिस्टम एंड हेंस द आर्टरीज विल डायलेट बट नॉट द वेन्स इट डज नॉट डायलेट द वेन्स. Some of the adverse effects are constipation, flushing, dizziness, headache, fatigue, and gingival enlargement. Alpha adrenoreceptor blocking agent like prazosin and terazosin produce a competitive block of alpha-1 adrenoreceptors, They decrease the peripheral vascular resistance and lower arterial blood pressure by causing relaxation of both arterial and venous smooth muscles. So alpha 1 adrenal receptor blocking agent like prazosin will dilate both the arteries and veins, and calcium channel blocker will not. Centrally acting adrenergic drugs, they are centrally acting vasodilators such as clonidine and methyl-dopa. They act as alpha 2 adrenergic receptor agonist in the vasomotor center within the medulla. The clonidine diminishes the central adrenergic outflow, decreasing the firing rate of the sympathetic nerves and amount of norepinephrine release. It is useful in treatment of hypertension complicated by renal diseases. Some of the adverse effects of centrally acting adrenergic drugs are dryness of mouth and eyes, sedation, bradycardia, impotence, and sudden withdrawal causes withdrawal symptoms. So whenever we are giving a patient clonidine, if the physician needs to switch the patient in to another drug, they have to stop the drug very slowly, not abruptly. A slow dose kam karke usko phir khatam karenge, aur aise nahi khatam karenge. Then vasodilators, mechanism of action is vasodilators act by producing relaxation of the vascular smooth muscles, which decreases resistance and therefore blood pressure. Hydralazine causes direct vasodilation, acting primarily on arteries and arterioles. This results in decreased peripheral resistance, which in turn prompts a reflex elevation in heart rate and cardiac output. They can cause reflex tachycardia, palpitation, sodium and water retention. They can be countered by giving it with diuretics, and which can be countered by giving it with diuretics and beta blockers. And hydralazine monotherapy is an accepted method of controlling blood pressure in pregnancy-induced hypertension. So in pregnancy-induced hypertension, hydralazine is the first line of drug that we use. So the antihypertensive to be avoided in pregnancy are diuretics because of the risk of placental wastage and stillbirths. AC inhibitors because of risk of fetal damage and growth retardation, and beta blockers because of low birth weight and neonatal bradycardia and hypoglycemia. So these are a few things that you need to remember. Diuretics, AC inhibitors, and beta blockers are a no-no for pregnancy-induced hypertension. Then drugs to be in specific conditions, like in asthma, peripheral vascular disease, and diabetes, beta blockers are not to be given. Hyperlipidemia, thiazide and beta blockers should not be given. In gout, thiazide diuretics cannot be given because they cause hyperuricemia. And in sexually active males, beta blockers and diuretics are not to be given because beta blockers' adverse effect is sexual dysfunction. Then, what is resistance hypertension? It is defined and defined as blood pressure that remains elevated despite administration of optimal three drug regimes that include a diuretic. That means that you have already given three drugs, which including a diuretic drug, but still the blood pressure is not in control. So what can be the most common causes of resistant hypertension? That can be poor compliance, excess ethanol intake, concomitant conditions like diabetes, obesity, sleep apnea, hyperaldosteronism, high salt intake, or any other metabolic syndromes. Then there can be concomitant medications like sympathetomimetics, NSAIDs, and antidepressant medication, and insufficient dosing of the medication. So then comes hypertensive emergency. What is hypertensive emergency? It is a very rare but a very life-threatening situation in which the diastolic blood pressure is either greater than 150 millimeters of mercury with the systolic blood pressure greater than 210 millimeters mercury in an otherwise healthy person. And it is also it can be greater than 130 millimeters of mercury in an individual with pre-existing complications such as encephalopathy, cerebral hemorrhage, left ventricular failure, or aortic stenosis. the cutoff mark for hypertensive emergency in patients with other diseases, pre-existing complication, is 130 millimeter mercury for the diastolic pressure. And with a patient which is otherwise healthy, it is 150 millimeter mercury of diastolic pressure. That would be a hypertensive emergency. And some of the drugs that are used in a hypertensive emergency are sodium nitroprusside, labetalol, and nitroglycerin. They're all given IV because we need